بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. So far, alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa mannihi wa fadlihi, we've completed so far in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the tafseer of the Qur'an, the beginning of revelation to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also the beginning of the nubuwah, the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the tafseer of the Qur'an. And the surah that related to this, or the verses that related to this, is found in Surah Al-Alaq. After this, we moved on to the beginning of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a rasul, as a messenger. The beginning of the risala, the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, meaning the beginning of the conveying of da'wah. Because once you become a messenger, it's obligatory, from what we started previously, to do what? To convey that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to you. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhar rasul, balligh. O messenger, relate, convey that which has been sent to you, min Rabbik, from your Lord. So the surah which was relating to this was what surah? Al-Muddathir. And that's why the ulama, they say, Nubbiya bil-Iqra, he became a prophet with Iqra, Surah Al-Alaq. Wa ursila bil-Muddathir, and became a rasul with Al-Muddathir. Now after the beginning of conveying of the da'wah, we looked at the next surah, which was how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the path according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gained spiritual nourishment. That was in Al-Muzammil. After this, we look at spiritual healing in the path of da'wah, which is in Surah Al-Qalam. And after this, we looked at a surah which covers everything that came before it and will cover everything that will come after it. And that was Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book, Surah Al-Fatiha. Now, inshallah ta'ala, for the next 6 weeks, we're going to move into the next phase, which is Ad-Da'wah to Jahriya, the open propagation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we'll look at some surah or some verses which relate to them. Unfortunately, because of time constraint, we're not going to look at every single surah, just some surah at this stage of open propagation. So we start, inshallah ta'ala, in our 6 weeks with one surah. And in these 6 weeks, we're going to cover how many surah? Three. Because 1 week we talk about Asbab al-Nuzul, why the surah is revealed, or the context it was revealed in. And the next week we give an explanation of the surah. So the surah we're going to start with today, inshallah ta'ala, in the beginning of revelation, is Surah Al-Masad. Surah Al-Masad. This marked the beginning of a da'wah al-jahriya, the open propagation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As for the Sabab al-Nuzul, the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down this surah, it is said, and pay attention to the word in here. It is said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amara rasulahu, he ordered his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ordered him to warn his nearest kinsmen or his nearest tribemen, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after this order, kharaja fasu'ida ala as-safa. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came out and he climbed on Mount As-Safa. And Mount Safa is one of the highest mountains in Mecca. If you've been for Umrah, like Sheikh Luqman here, many a times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is blessing with the opportunity to go for Umrah. Now they've cut the mountain down, but in the past it was a very high mountain. And any time they wanted to make an announcement, an important announcement, they'll climb on As-Safa. So if you go for Umrah, you have As-Safa wal Marwa. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he climbed upon Mount As-Safa. فَبَدَأَ يُنَادِ وَجَعَلَ يُنَادِ. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started to pronounce in a loud voice, يَا بَنِي فِهْرٍ يَا بَنِي عَدِي. He started to call the tribes. Oh, the tribe of Fihr, the tribe of Adi, oh, Al Quraysh. So when they heard this call, they realized this was very important. And a call is also dependent on the one that's making the call. And the one making the call here is who? From the nobles of Quraysh, Hashimi, from the Hashimis. And not only any other person made the call from Hashimi, but a person who was known in Jahiliyyah as what? As-Sadiq al-Amin. The truthful and the trustworthy. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam made this call, so important it was for the Quraysh that whoever could not make it, arsala rasulan. He sent a messenger to hear what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam had to say. So when they all gathered up and they were all there, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said to them, ara'aytum. What is your opinion? What do you think? In akhbartukum anna khaylan takhruju min safhi hadha al-jabal turid an tughira alaykum akuntum musaddiqi. What do you think? If I was to tell you right now that an ambush is about to take place or to be launched from behind this mountain or from this mountain. And what mountain is talking about? Safa. That if I was to tell you there's an ambush happening right now from this mountain, and they could see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they could see Mount Safa, that if I was to tell you there's an ambush happening right now, would you believe me? The Quraysh said, na'am, bala, indeed. Ma jarabna alayka al-kadhib. We've never known you to lie. Then after this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, inni lakum. In fact, I'm about to warn you something more severe than that. Inni lakum nadhirun mubin. Bayna yaday adhabun alim. That I'm about to warn you of a severe punishment before it comes to you. At this point, the whole of Quraysh, they kept quiet. Because not anybody is making this proclaimant but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Except for one person, Abu Lahab. Abu Lahab was the only person that smoked. And he's the first person to begin open hatred or opposition to the da'wah. Abu Lahab, he spoke and he said, Alihada jama'atana? You mean you gathered us all together for this? Tabban laka sa'ir al-yawm. The word tabba is a very strong word. Khasira wa halika. May your day, may you be destroyed, your day be destroyed, and be lost for the rest of today and after today. At this point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down his saying, tabbat yada abi lahabin wa tabba. So this was a sabab nuzul hadhi ayah. So in the very beginning, it was the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that made the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do this, to go on Mount Safa, which is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. Warn your nearest kin or tribesmen. Now note, I said the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you go to many books of Seerah, you find they always put this as sabab al-nuzul, the cause of this revelation of Surah Al Masad, or the beginning of open da'wah, this ayah. But if this is the beginning of revelation, what ayah should we be doing then today? We should be doing this, if we're going in order. So we should begin with Surah Al-Shu'ara, verse 47. Yes, but we begin with Surah Al-What? Al-Masad. Sahih? So when you go to any book of Seerah, or people giving lecture about the open da'wah, they'll say, when the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came down, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ وَخْفِضْ جَنَاحَكَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. They always quote this surah. But the reason we're starting with Surah Al-Masad, لإختلاف, because of a difference of opinion. And that ikhtilaf is, some say that this ayah is not what began the open propagation. The revelation of this ayah is not linked to Surah Al-Masad. This ayah is an ayah in the Quran, but it came down in the middle or the mid of Meccan period, of da'wah of Meccan period, not in the beginning. But in order for us to understand this difference of opinion, let's go back to sabab al-nuzul, the reason these verses were revealed in Surah Al-Masad according to Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. In the Sahih of Imam Al-Bukhari, and Bukhari is the most authentic book after the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala brought forth the hadith Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said, Lamma nazalat, when it was sent down, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ وَرَحْتَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلِصِينَ. That when the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was sent down, that warned your nearest kin and your family from amongst them, those who are believers, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kharaja, he left for sa'id al-safa, he climbed upon safa, and he said, Ya sabaha, in another narration, Wa sabaha. What does Ya Sabaha mean? What does Wa Sabaha mean? There's no translation or particular meaning. Because that we mentioned the Arabs, they had adawatu tanbih, ways of drawing your attention or alarming you. So if they wanted to alarm you with something, they'll say, wa sabaha, meaning this is important. It's like an alarm and alert. But what we noted in the very beginning, what do you notice when I said this hadith of Ibn Abbas? Wa anzir ashiratak al aqrabin. And your family from amongst them, the believers. Whereas the ayah you always find in the beginning of the biblical series is always what? Wakhfid, lower your wings to the believers. So rahtaka. This is not an ayah from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no such verse as this in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no such verse. So for that reason, they say nazala, descended upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, means some scholars say it was a wahi, it was a revelation to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it was not what? Qur'an. It was a revelation, but not what? The Qur'an. Continuing. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this was, it was ordered with it, he mentioned the hadith, he mentioned that we mentioned the previous hadith about if an army was to attack you. Now, it is said because of that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Tabbat yada abi lahabin wa tabba." Tayyib. What about the other narrations in which we have? That also is a hadith, and you find the hadith also in Bukhari and Muslim. And it actually brings the ayah, which is, "Wa anzir ashiratakal aqrabin wa khfid janahaka lil mu'minin." The author of the book said, as for the other narrations, this narration was concerned the mid-stage of Makkah. Because anytime you look at the cause of reasons of this narration, there's no mention of who? Abu Lahab. Secondly, the actions which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took on, if you go to the tafseer of this ayah, after the revelation of this ayah, warn your nearest kin, is different to what? What he did where? In Surah Al Masad. And we'll give an example of that. In the hadith, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, hadith you find in Muslim and also in Al-Bukhari, that when the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came down, now this is the ayah now, when this was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, that when this ayah came down, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَا مَعْشَرَ قُرَيْشِ اِشْتَرُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا أُغْنِي عَنْكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا. O Quraysh, save yourself from the fire. I could not avail you in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This action here, is it the same as when he called them the first time? Two different actions. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya bani Abdul Manaf, la ugni ankum min Allahi shay'a. O the sons of Abdul Manaf, I could not avail you in front of Allah azza wa jal. Ya Abbas, he called out his uncle specifically, Abbas, who was from the brothers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. La ugni anka min Allah shay'a. Ya Safiya, O Safiya. And what is Safiya to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The aunt, the maternal or paternal, paternal aunt of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That could not avail you in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he called, Ya Umma Zubayr, O mother of Zubayr, was also aunt of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I could not avail you in front of Allah azza wa jal. And then he said, Ya Fatima, O Fatima, bintu Muhammad, the daughter of Muhammad, I could not avail you in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all. So here we have two different actions. Also, in another riwayah, another narration, it is reported that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he called them generally according to their tribes, according to their fathers, and he called them specifically. So we have two different actions. Therefore, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, warn your nearest kinsmen. It came when? In the middle of Meccan period. As for, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ وَرَحْتَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلِصِينَ, this was what? An order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some scholars say it's not from the Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because there's no such verse. And some other scholars are opinion that this verse was actually abrogated. Al-Muhim, that which is like a consensus agreed, that which came after Fatiha was Surah Al Masad. So in this surah, or the sabab nuzul of this, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he climbed upon Mount As-Safa and he called them. And this shows husnul adab. the good form of conveyance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And anybody who is in education or wants to be a teacher and you want to learn educational theories, there's no better example than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When I started to do my MA in education, a lot of things from the Sunnah started to click back to me, like subhanallah, that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would do such and such. Like activating a person's schemata, activating the background knowledge of somebody so it can relate to what you're talking about. There was no one better than that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why the Sahabi said, ma ra'aytu mu'alliman qat, I've never seen a teacher, qablahu wala ba'dahu, I've never seen a teacher before or after who was better than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because even in the beginning of this da'wah, look how he began. That he's standing in front of a people like I'm standing here, I'm sitting there right now. And I was to say, Ya Abu Hanifa, Ya Luqman, if I was to tell you there's an army about to invade and ambush us from behind this minbar, would you believe me? Immediately, you think I'm crazy because there's nothing behind me. But to show the trust they had in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they said, we believe him. What is he trying to relate to them here? To relate to them a nubuwwah, what prophethood is about. Because these are people, no prophet has ever come to them before. No books. That in the same way, you believe me in that which you cannot see, even though it's in front of you. The painful punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving knowledge of the what? Of the unseen. And that's why the Quraysh, they kept quiet. They had no refutation. That if we could believe you in this, likewise, anything which is unseen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it to the Anbiya by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah ta'ala says, Alimul Ghayb, that Allah ta'ala is the only knower of the unseen. فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَى غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا. No one knows the unseen. إِلَّا مَنْ ارْتَضَى مِنْ رَسُولٍ. Except for the one Allah ta'ala is pleased with, for the messengers, and he gives him the unseen. So look at the beginning of the da'wah, and that's why سَكَتَ Quraysh. The whole of the Quraysh, they kept quiet. They couldn't say anything except for one person, Abu Lahab, who said, Tabban lak, perish, destroyed, and the loss is your day and after today. So from the very beginning of the message, it shows how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he conveyed this message. So after this, they kept quiet. And initially, that which he's come with is not really going to affect them. Who is with him? When we study the first Muslims, some slaves, young man, one free man. So the Quraysh left the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to do his da'wah. So in the very beginning, it was to his closest what? Kins and tribes people. But then Allah ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِ. We say it to the whole of the universe, jinn and mankind. So now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to go outside the tribes. And this is where the issue began, in the beginning of the da'wah. That when he started to go outside the tribes, no matter what the country was, the tribe was, he started to call them, and people started to accept Islam. This is where the issue, Sunnatul Ibtila, which we're going to speak about for the next, inshallah ta'ala, 5 weeks after today, the Sunnah of test and trial from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's nobody more severe or more tested than the Anbiya of Allah azza wa jal. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ashadda an-nas ibtila'an, the more severe in test, the Anbiya, the Prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلْ فَالْأَمْثَلْ, those who are nearest to them in Iman. There's nobody more tested. Because sometimes, in the concept of people's understanding of Allah Azza wa Jal, or the Creator or God, people, they have this concept, I do me, the Almighty, and you do you, until I need you. So their belief of God is only meant to give you that which you are happy with. And many Muslims have this concept that they cannot take ibtila, test and trials, but there's nobody more tested than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most beloved, but yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was born as a what? As an orphan. And if you look at all the trials the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to, an anbiya of Allah azza wa jal. So began the Sura Ibtila, trials and tribulation for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believers. I'm going to be going through next week Surah Taqwir, because Surah Taqwir is of importance, and I'll mention why now. Before mentioning Sunnah al-Ibtila, the trials and tribulation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we want to know why is it that these people, they sought to harm the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, expel the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because in understanding that, contemporarily, we understand why people may oppose the da'wah of al-Islam today. The first reason is the fundamental reason behind which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent all the prophets, all the messengers. And what is the fundamental reason? At-tawheed. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ. We never sent a messenger. إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ. Except we inspired him, we give him wahi. أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. That there's nothing worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the thing with the mushrikeen, which is what Imam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned, he said the mushrikeen in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, عجب العجال. He said they understood tawheed more than some of the Muslims today, which is why they rejected it. They knew what la ilaha illallah, they knew what it meant. They knew the consequences, so they rejected it. They rejected it immediately. In fact, he said in some aspects of tawheed, they were even better, because they recognized one tawheed. And that tawheed was what? Tawheed al-rububiyyah, in terms of creation. Allah is the only creator. And that's why when Allah Ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is iqra bismillah, it is iqra bismi rabbik. Because they acknowledge Allah is the creator. Wa la in sa'altahu ma khalaqa as-samawati wal ard la yaquluna Allah. If you so ask who created heaven and earth, they'll say who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, the mushrikeen, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as much as they recognize rububiyyah when it came to acts of ibadah, the associate partners of Allah Azza wa Jal, he said they were still better. And in what sense? Muhammad Abdul Wahhab gave an example. And there's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for this example, which is a sahabi Jaleel, Hussein, or Hussein. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once asked Hussein. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, Ya Hussein, kam ilahan ta'bud? Oh Hussein, how many gods do you worship? He said, 7. With no shyness, nothing at all, radiallahu ta'ala an. Because some of them had more, innumerable gods. He said, 7. He said, where are they? He said, 6 fil ardi wa wahidun fis sama. He said, 6 on the earth and 1 in the heaven. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, إِذَا اشْتَدَّ بِكَ الْأَمْرِ. When things become very difficult for you and there's nowhere out, who do you call upon? He said, Alladhi fi sama, the one in the heavens, subhanAllah. And recently, ajib, I never read this book of English literature before. When many people ask me, where are you originally from? And I always say, I'm a Nigerian. Even though I was born and bred in England, but I'm Nigerian. When people ask me, where are you from? I say, I'm from Nigeria. And even my students, everybody know me as being Nigerian. I don't shy away from that fact. Now, people automatically that know about English literature, they always ask me the famous question. If you read the book, what's the famous book? Things Fall Apart by Chinua Achebe. And I felt guilty, I never read the book. I read Of Mice and Men, other books, you know, To Kill a Mockingbird, and other books in English literature, but I never read that book. So now, 40-something years later, I'm not gonna tell how old I am, 40-something years later, I decided to read the book. A few weeks ago, and subhanAllah, he was talking about the pre-colonial era, before the colonials that came with the missionaries that came with Christianity. And he's talking about an area where people are from pure shirk, the east of Nigeria. And these people, the same thing with this mushrik, exactly the same thing. When the missionaries came to them, and they came with a da'wah that resembled tawheed, because the root of religion was what? Monotheism. You don't know the shirk in it now. So when the missionaries came, the Christians came, and they saw them worshiping an idol, they had all the superstitions, they said to them, all these things you're worshiping, why do you worship these things? This is the book, you go back to it. They said, these things we're worshiping, they're not the supreme God. There's only one supreme God. And I forgot the Igbo word for the supreme God. That there's only one God. If things become too difficult, that's the one we go to. That's the only one we go to. And this was exactly the same shirk of Quraysh, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, that وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ, that those who take allies besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and gods besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know what the excuse was? مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We only worship them to bring us what? Closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The same exact shirk, which is Muhammad Abdul Wahhab said, those of them, those days, they were better. If things become too bad, da'u Allah mukhlisin, they call upon Allah Azza wa Jal. Where you have some Muslims today, they'll say, Ya Sheikh Fulani, Ya Wali Fulani, when things become too difficult. A'udhu Billah. The mushrikeen will call upon Allah Azza wa Jalla. In those days, today, Ya Sheikh Fulani, Ya Afa Fulani, A'udhu Billah. They will do this. So the mushrikeen in that concept of those days, they knew. I remember when I first started trying to practice Islam, one of the first books I got, to show how deep that book was called The Secrets of Secrets. The Secrets of Secrets. Because the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is simple. There's no secrets of secrets. There's no sir. And when I got this book, no jokes, it gave me a migraine, made me dizzy. Some of the books I used to read, it will make you dizzy. I got this book, I was reading it. The mushrikeen in those days, they believed the only creator is who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the things I read in this book, and it's supposed to be about the mu'jizah of a righteous person, a Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani. But what has been invented against him are lies. That one day, the Sheikh, rahimahullah azza wa jalla, was eating chicken, and his student was eating crumbs of bread. And while he was eating these crumbs of bread, the student's mother turned up and said, Taqillah, ya Sheikh, how could you be eating this chicken? And your student is eating these crumbs of bread, these meager grains of bread everywhere. And Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani, it was reported, A'udhu Billah, that he pointed to the bones of the chicken and the meat gathered around the bone. And the flesh gathered around it. And then the feathers came on the chicken came back alive, started to say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, Abdul Qadir Waliullah. Ajib. In another thing, that we said, the mushrikeen of those days, they only called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no peer, there's no afa, there's no holy, only Allah azza wa jal. In the same book, you said once a woman was being attacked. And she, Ya Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani. And he was in another far distant place making wudu. And he took off his shoes, threw it into the air. And he knocked out the rapist, the person to attack her. So they were better in that sense. So, moving on. The problem they had was a tawheed al-uluhiyya, ibadah. That only Allah deserves to be worshipped. They understood what it meant. That you cannot say, I'm worshipping Allah and worship other than Allah. You only have to worship who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because anytime you associate a partner with Allah azza wa jalla, that act of worship is not called ibadah, it's called what? Shirk. That's what Allah ta'ala said in Hadith Qudsi. Man amila amalan, whoever does an action, ashraka ma'iya fi, he associates a partner with me in doing it, taraktuhu. I leave him an act of worship, taraktuhu wa shirka. I leave him any shirk, not him and his ibadah. So they understood this. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Qur'an, in Surah As-Sad, وَعَجِبُوا أَنْ جَاءَهُمْ مُنْذِرٌ مِّنْهُمْ وَقَالَ الْكَافِرُونَ هَذَا سَاحِرٌ كَذَّابٌ. They were in wonder and amazement that a warner has come to men from amongst them. So they say, هَذَا سَاحِرٌ كَذَّابٌ. He's a magician, he's a liar. Why? Why is he a magician and a liar? What amazed them? أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا. Subhanallah. That as Muhammad made all the gods one God, they understood. And they went on to say, as he made the gods one God, inna hadha la shay'un ujab. This is something which is we're unfamiliar with, which is strange. And they went on to say, وَانْطَلَقَ الْمَلَأُ مِنْهُمْ أَنِمْشُوا وَاصْبِرُوا عَلَى آلِهَتِكُمْ إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءٌ يُرَادُ مَا سَمِعْنَا بِهَذَا فِي الْمِلَّةِ الْآخِرَةِ. They went on to say that a lead from amongst them, that continue with false idols, be patient upon your gods. This is what is intended. We've never heard of this in the latest of religion. In hadha illa ikhtilaq. This is nothing but a fabrication. So they rejected it immediately. They knew what it meant indeed immediately. So their problem was with tawheed ar-rububiyyah, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. They knew what it meant. They knew what la ilaha illallah meant. That doesn't mean there's no God but Allah. It means there's nothing, no deity worthy of worship of who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other problem they had was in tawheed. What's the other category of tawheed, ya Salman? In the Salman. Salman. Naam. We have three. Rububiyyah, they were kind of fine with that. That Allah is the creator. We have worship. And what's the other one? Barakallahu fika Salman. Asma sifat. Names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because their concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was wrong. So one of the concept they had, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lahu sahiba, he had a partner, a female partner. Ta'ala Allahu an dhalika 'uluwan kabira. And this female partner gave birth to girls. And these girls were who? The angels. So they call the angels the daughters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why such ayat, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, came down. وَجَعَلُوا لِلَّهِ شُرَكَاءَ الْجِنِّ وَخَلَقَهُمْ وَخَرَقُوا لَهُ بَنِينَ وَبَنَاتٍ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. That they've made for Allah ta'ala partners from the jinn. But Allah created the jinn. And they invented for him sons and daughters without any knowledge. Subhanahu wa ta'ala amma yasifoon. Exalted and the high above is that which they attribute to him. Badi'u samawati wal ard. Allah ta'ala says he's the originator or creator of the heaven and earth. Anna yakun lahu walad. How could he have a son? Wa lam takun lahu sahiba. And yet he has no partner. What does a partner mean, has sahiba? No wife. And I refer again back to the same book. What book is that? Yes, things fall apart. When the Christians, when they're about to convince this mushrikeen, subhanAllah, to show them for da'at tawheed, and I'm reading this book, because these people had crazy superstitions. The first time they saw a white man, they said, we've seen an albino on a metal horse. You know what the metal horse was? A bicycle. How shirk makes you illiterate. And the albino, they said, this albino has magic we've never seen before. Because they all believed in magic. So when the missionaries came, because what they did, when they saw that person who was albino, they slaughtered him, Allah told, they cut him up and chopped him up. And then the missionaries came to give them da'wah now. Everything they said was making sense to them. You know what? At the end of the day, these things cannot harm, they can't benefit us, the idols. But you know what kept them on their deen of shirk? When they explained now the concept of the Trinity. They said, God has a son. At that point, because the fitrah was in them, the natural disposition, they said, we cannot accept this. Because if God has a son, that means he has a wife. Because they believed in marriage. If God doesn't have a wife, how could he have a son? They rejected it immediately. That if the da'wah of Tawheed reached them first and foremost, they will accept the deen of Allah. They could not accept that concept. Me and Luqman both know of a person that is not really of a religion. And inshallah, Allah guide him to Islam. But he could not accept that concept of the Trinity of God having a son, the begotten son of God. He could not accept it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَجَعَلُوا لِلَّهِ وَجَعَلُوا بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ الْجِنَّةِ نَسَبًا وَلَقَدْ عَلِمَتِ الْجِنَّ أَنَّهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ لَمُحْدَرُونَ. Also the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ لَيْسُمُّونَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ تَسْمِيَةَ الْأُنْثَى. Those that don't believe in the last day, they give the names of girls to the angels, because they believe they're what? The daughters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مَا لَهُمْ مِنْ عِلْمٍ. They have no knowledge. In يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنِّ. They don't follow anything but conjectures. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in refuting them, one of the refutation Allah ta'ala refuted the mushrikeen was that the mushrikeen, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to a people, they used to bury their girl children alive. Allah ta'ala asked them, أَأَصْفَاكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ بِالْبَنِينَ وَاتَّخَذَ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَ إِنَاثًا. Your Lord gives you sons, which you're so proud of, but yet he chooses for himself what? Daughters. Angels as daughters. Subhanallah. Because to them, a daughter was a shame. Once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is going back in Seerah to show what kind of people were sent to, there was a Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And this Sahabi radiallahu anhu was always extremely sad. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would see this Sahabi, would speak to him, and he noticed he's always sad. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one day asked him, why are you always sad? Why are you always distressed? He told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once he went on a journey, and the Arabs in those days, they used to go on long journeys, and he came back. After coming back, or before going, his wife had conceived. She was pregnant, and she had delivered. So when he came back from this journey, and he found what she's given birth to was a female child, he was so heartbroken. And she had grown enough to reach that age or that stage where she could utter words and she could speak. And he looked at her. And you know, if you have daughters, the connection between a father and his daughters. The boys will be jealous of that anyway. Don't be jealous. And he looked at this girl, and he knew, or he felt in himself, there's only one thing I could do. And the tradition in those days was, bury her alive. So he said to his wife, I'm going to go out with my daughter. His wife is that she had a feeling, intuition, which mothers have, that لا تضيع الأمانة. Do not misplace this trust. And he promised, I'm not going to misplace this trust. She knew what he was going to do. And he took the girl out and he held her. And he looked at her, something very difficult to do is about to do. And he dug, he put her in the dust, subhanAllah. Some of them, the little girl actually hold their fingers while they've been buried, subhanAllah. And he buried her alive. And as he buried her, he heard a voice, Ya Abata, O Father, طيعت الأمانة. You've lost this trust. That which you've been entrusted with, you've lost it, subhanAllah. And that stayed with him, that voice, he rang it and echoed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if I was to punish people for what they did in Jahiliyyah, it would be the first person I'll punish. So if they could attribute to Allah Ta'ala a daughter, but they're pleased with son, it makes no sense. So they had issues in asma or sifat. The last issue, which we're going to mention inshallah Ta'ala, or maybe next week, bi-idhnillahi Ta'ala, was in the affairs of the Yawm al-Akhir, the last days. That they could not believe that they'd be resurrected. And inshallah Ta'ala, we'll mention this when we do Surah Al-Takwir. Because 2 weeks now, I'm going to Surah Al-Takwir. And Surah Al-Takwir, they say, Man arada, whoever wants to imagine or envisage Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day of judgment, as though he could see before his eyes, let him read Surah Al-Takwir. Either Shamsu Kuwirat. So inshallah Ta'ala, in 2 weeks, we'll do that. And also the other issue they had was the Qur'an in itself, and also the personality of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they could not accept the concept that a man is a prophet, human. And that's why, to show subhanAllah, that shirk is a form of stupidity and insanity, that the scholars say, رَسُولٌ مِنَ الْبَشَرِ مُسْتَحِيلٌ وَلَكِنْ إِلَهٌ مِنَ الْبَقَرَ مُمْكِنٌ. That a prophet was a human, unacceptable, impossible. But a god who is a cow, acceptable. To show the stupidness of a shirk and disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why no matter what level of education a person has, there's nobody that has more aql than what? Believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Than a believer in Allah azza wa jal. And we should always have that, no matter this person's a doctor, this person's whatever, is nothing but intellectual garbage if not an iman. Subhanaka wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Any questions, inshallah? The only thing I say once again saddens me greatly, and Qaisar mentioned this point, I will not be able to go through every single surah. Because subhanAllah, you know, in this beginning period alone, we have Surah Al-Takwir. Lastly, we have Surah Al-Kafirun. We have, you know how many surah? How many do you think? 10. 10. But we're only going to go through how many? 3, inshallah. Maybe in another time we'll go through all of them, because it's very important to go through all of them. Now, any questions? No.